Hello, teachers. Ben Jennings here, and we are in session number 7 of our study in Genesis. It includes Genesis 8, verse 10 to 22. And the subject of today's lesson is restoration. We're talking about God restoring Noah after the flood and what happens there. And so the big idea of this lesson, as I put it in the notes, is when we put our trust in God, the restoration that God has promised will cause us to experience three stages of restoration. There's the first stage is waiting for restoration, then experiencing restoration, and thankfulness for restoration. Those are the three stages. You see I'm dressed up today. I just finished a funeral of a lady who went home to be with the Lord. And when you're at a funeral, you are celebrating when those people that are that you're doing the funeral for actually have a testimony that they know Christ. There is a sense in which they are being restored. Their salvation is being fully fulfilled in the sense that they're going to be with God, to be absent from the bodies, to be present with the Lord. There was a time where they heard the gospel, they got saved, and they have been saved. As they grow along in their life, they are being saved. And then one day when they get to heaven, they will be saved. And that's what we celebrate today, the homegoing of this lady that was in her church that knew Christ. So I say all that to say that there is a restoration that is available. And that's what we're seeing here in this particular passage. Noah has been saved in the sense that he didn't drown when the water came down. He's in the ark. He and his family, they're trusting in Christ. They are trusting in God. They've gotten into the ark. The ark is saving them. And then the ark is getting them to this point of full restoration. And so there's going to be some similarities here to how we experience salvation, how we're experiencing the time in between when we got saved and when we will be saved. When we put our trust in God, the restoration that God has promised will cause us to experience three stages. Now, we're going to see in Noah's life this first stage, waiting for restoration. Let's read this together. It says, "And he stayed yet another 7 days again, and again he sent forth the dove out of the ark. And the dove came into him in the evening, and lo, in her mouth was an olive leaf plucked off. So Noah knew that the waters were abated from off the earth, and he stayed yet another 7 days and sent forth a dove, which returned not again unto him any more. And it came to pass in the 600th and first year, in the first month, the first day of the month, that waters were dried up from off the earth. And Noah removed the covering off of the ark and looked, and behold, the face of the ground was dry. And in the second month, on the 7th and 20th day of this month, was the earth dried." And so you have Noah, who's been on the ark, he has been saved in the flood. The rains have stopped. We see that the waters are beginning to abate. They're beginning to go down. And we find that the ark rests. It has rested here on Ararat in verses 4 and 5. But it takes them so long, the waters, to continue to recede over and over and over again. And so you have him here resting on this mountain, but still water everywhere, and he's waiting and waiting and waiting for that full time of restoration. Now, this particular passage is a narrative. It's just telling you what happened. So as I kind of apply it to our lives, it's just serving as an illustration of how restoration happens, of how salvation happens. God bringing Noah back to a place where he can get on the earth again, where he can live again on the earth. And that's exactly what's going on here in this particular passage. And so he's waiting, and that's exactly what goes on. Verse 10 through 14, you see that he gives out the first and that the first dove, and then that dove came back. He sent out another dove, and that one never came back. So he's got somewhere to go. And it tells you specifically days here. It gives you specific history, specific moments of when this is going on and what's happening, which I think is a really interesting thing. This is an actual history of what happened. But you have this waiting for full salvation, for restoration. Then you're going to go on and see number two, experiencing restoration. And that's where we get to verse 15. Here's what it says. And God spake unto Noah, saying, go forth of the ark, thou and thy wife and thy son, thy sons and thy sons' wives with thee. Bring forth with thee every living thing that is with thee, and all flesh, both of fowl and of cattle, and of every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth, that they may breed abundantly in the earth, and be fruitful, and multiply the earth. And Noah went forth, and his sons, and his wife's sons with him, every beast, every creeping thing, and every fowl, and whatsoever creepeth upon the earth after their kinds, went forth out of the ark. Can you imagine coming off the ark after being on there for all that time? They were on there, they're on the ark a really, really long time. It says, calculating from 7:11 to 8:13, this is in the lesson. Noah and the family spent 1 year and 11 days in the ark with the animals. Notice verses 13 to 14 put strong emphasis on the condition of the ground by being dry, mentioning it three times in those two verses. Could you imagine them coming off the ark after they had been there for a year, over a year and 11, a year and 11 days? That is an amazing amount of time to be in one particular edifice, one particular, well, it's a boat, one big ship. That's a long time to be in one particular setting. And it was a big boat, but can you imagine going? Imagine going to church Sunday and not leaving for a year and 11 days, never getting off of it. That would just be an amazing amount, an amazing feat. A lot of planning had to go into that. So they were waiting, 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 waiting. They got on the ark to be saved, but then yet getting to the time where they can go back to their life before, where they weren't living on the ark a year. And eventually God comes and says, okay, now it's time. You can get off the ark. You can bring all those animals that you saved with you, and you can experience being restored fully back to living on dry land. What an incredible thing. And you see in verse number 17, almost another mandate to multiply, to be fruitful and multiply. Right after God had given that mandate to Adam and Eve, now he's giving it again to Adam, or sorry, to Noah, his wife, and their kids. Be fruitful and multiply on the earth. And so that's exactly what happened. They came off the ark and they experienced that restoration. And then we get to this last point. You see a gratefulness or a thankfulness for restoration. Verse 20, and Noah builded an altar and took of every clean beast and of every clean fowl and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor, and the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake, for the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth, and neither will I again smite any more every living thing as I have done. While the earth remaineth seed time and harvest, the cold and heat, and summer and winter, one day and night shall not cease. And a day and night shall not cease. What an amazing thing. Noah expresses gratitude to God. He expresses thankfulness to God in the form of an altar, in the form of worship. And, you know, we know that God had told him to take two of every animal, but for the clean animals, he was supposed to take seven. And at least a part of the reason why that was the case is because he knew that there would be a sacrifice that would happen later on. So here Noah is sacrificing to God, and God is responding with a promise. He's responding to make God, and in his own heart saying, I'm not gonna flood the earth again. That's not how I'm gonna destroy the world. And so what an amazing thing. I think there is an application here for our lives. When we put our faith and trust in Christ, it's not a whole lot different than Noah with the ark. Trouble was coming. Why was trouble coming? It was judgment. Why was it judgment? Why was there judgment? There was judgment because of man's sin. But God said that Noah, he was going to be gracious to Noah. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And so Noah was essentially because of his faith, because he was a righteous man, God said to Noah, hey, I'm going to, you're going to get grace from me. I'm going to build an ark and I'm starting over with you. And so you need to trust me. You need to be obedient. You, by faith, you need to do what you're supposed to do. And that is build an ark for the saving of you and your family. There was enough room for more than just him and his family on there. But those are the ones that trusted in God by being obedient to God and going in the ark. Then judgment came. And while the rest of the world was judged, Noah and his family believed God. And by faith, by being on the ark, they trusted in God's provision. And because of that, they were saved. But their salvation, the belief that caused the salvation came instantly. When they got on the ark and it started flooding, they were saved that way. But they weren't fully restored back to what it was like beforehand until the water receded and God said, you can come out. And there is a... That often is how things happen. That's often how our salvation is. We are saved when we put our faith and trust in Christ. We had a young lady this week who a Sunday school teacher shared the gospel with her, and she believed. She believed about Jesus. She believed that Jesus died for her sins. She called on Jesus to save her, and she is now saved. But she's still on this earth. She still has to live this life. She's going to sin again. God's already paid for that sin. She is now in Christ. But until the Lord comes back and receives us, as the Bible tells us in Thessalonians, or until she dies and goes to be with Jesus, she will not experience full restoration of being without the curse, without the effects of sin. We've been saved from the penalty of sin, and one day we'll be saved from the presence of sin. But although we're saved from the penalty of sin now, we're not going to be taken from the presence of sin until one day when we go to be with Jesus. That being said, how can we apply this lesson to our lives? Well, there's a time right now we're waiting for full restoration to happen. We still live in this world and we're waiting to experience restoration. We need to be thankful for what God does in our lives. God does save us and is restoring things in our lives before we are fully restored in heaven one day. But God's blessing us now as we're in this in-between time. And we need to be thankful for God's salvation, for what he's done for us, for how he has helped us and loved us and forgiven us. And one day we can look forward to the fact that we're going to be fully restored. We're going to be fully with him, and we shall be like him because we'll see him as he is. It's going to be an amazing thing. In the meantime, what we need to be telling people is get on the ark, right? We trust in Christ. He's the only one that can save. And so that's what we need to do. This is an amazing lesson. It's really just the second half. It's the fulfillment of what actually happens in the story of Noah. And there is sometimes some pain in the waiting. There's some, we all long, don't we, for Christ to come back. We long for sin and death to be over, and one day it will be over. That's going to be an amazing thing. But until then, we need to wait expectantly for God to move, and we need to be thankful even ahead of time for what he's going to do, and thankful for what he's doing now. I hope this was a help to you, and I hope that as you teach this lesson to your class on Sunday, that it will be a blessing to them. And if there's not lost people showing up to your class, make that a matter of prayer. Ask God to let your class be a Great Commission class that helps you to reach people that are like the people in your class, and have them come and get in God's word with you and hear the gospel and be saved. Hope you have a great day. Talk to you soon.